This is Wandle. Brilliance Audio presents the unabridged recording of Mexican White Boy by Matt de la Peña, performed by Henry Leyva. For the de la Peñas, my endless inspiration. Y especialmente mi abuelita Natividad Burgos de la Peña. Danny lands in National City. 1. Dressed in a well-worn billabong tee, camel cargo shorts, and a pair of old-school slip-on Vans, Danny Lopez follows his favorite cousin Sophia as she rolls up on the cul-de-sac crowd with OG swagger. A bunch of heads call out to her, "Hey, so, yo, girl, there she is," and wave. Sophia waves back, pulls Danny by the arm toward a group of girls sitting on a blanket in an uneven semicircle. "Oye, putas," she says. "Yo, this is my cousin Danny I was telling you about. He's gonna be staying with me for the summer." She smiles big, proud, Danny thinks. "Yo, cuz, these are my girls." She points them out and rattles off names. "Carmen, Raquel, Angela B, Juanita, Flaca, and Gita." "Hey," the girls sing song in unison. Danny nods with a shy smile, aims his eyes at the asphalt. He feels the heat of their stares, and for a second he wishes he could morph into one of the ants zigzagging in and out of tiny crevices in the street. Their little lives, he thinks, totally off the radar. Danny's 16, a shade over 6 foot, and only a year younger than Sophia, but unless he's on a pitching mound, he feels like a boy. He's long and thin, skinny arms hanging down skinny thighs, his arm length, the reason he can fire a fastball so hard. His shoulders are wide, but his muscles have yet to catch up. Sometimes when he sees himself in a mirror, it looks like his shirt is propped up by an upside-down coat hanger. Not a human body. It doesn't even look real. And Danny's brown. Half Mexican brown. A shade darker than all the white kids at his private high school, Leucadia Prep. Up there, Mexican people do under-the-table yard work and hide out in the hills because they're in San Diego illegally. Only other people on Leucadia's campus who share his shade are the lunch line ladies, the gardeners, the custodians. But whenever Danny comes down here, the National City, where his dad grew up, where all his aunts and uncles and cousins still live, he feels pale. A full shade lighter. Albino, almost. Less than. "And just so you know," Sophia adds, "Danny ain't no big talker, all right? He's mad smart, gets nothing but A's at the best private school in San Diego, but don't get your chonies in a bunch if you can't never pull him into a combo." Sophia looks prettier than Danny remembers, less of a tomboy. Her hair long now, makeup around her eyes. Carmen clears her throat, says, "You don't need to talk to give me no deep tissue massage." She gives Danny an exaggerated wink. "Ain't need no words for us to soak in a nice jacuzzi bath together," Flaca says. She reaches out, puts a hand on one of Danny's hands. "We can just sit there, Bobby, backs against them jet thingies, take turns sipping a little white zen and shit. How's that sound beautiful?" Danny gives her a polite smile, but inside he's shrinking. He's trying to suck back into his shell, like a poked and prodded snail. Behind his back, he grips his left wrist, digs his fingernails into the skin, until a sharp pain floods his mind, makes him feel real. Angela and B comb Danny over with their almond-shaped eyes, devour his out-of-place surfer style like a pack of rabid dogs. Danny cringes at how different he must seem to his cousin's friends. They're all dark chocolate colored, hair sprayed up, dressed in pro jerseys and Dickies, Timberlands, gold and silver chains, calligraphy-style tats. Danny's skin is too clean, too light, his clothes too soft. "Qué putas," Sophia says, slapping Flaca's hand away from Danny's shoe. "Leave my cousin alone already. He only just got here today." She turns to Danny, says, "I see my homegirl's gonna try and corrupt you, cuz. Better watch it, though. These hyenas got mad STDs." "Say what?" Carmen shouts. "For real? I see them jumping off like fleas." Sophia plays like she's swatting germs out of the air, stomping them on the ground. Danny sees all the girls are laughing, so he laughs, too. As Sophia switches topics, brings up their annual summer trip to the Del Mar Fair. "Speaking of alcohol, Flaca, which one of y'all is sneaking in the thermos of jungle juice?" Danny eyes a group of guys playing stickball at the mouth of the cul-de-sac. A wave of butterflies passes through his middle. His game. His pitching arm starts to tingle, his right elbow and fingertips, like he's already gripping the seams of a baseball. A Pavlovian response, he thinks, recalling his psych teacher's chicken scratch scrawl on a chalkboard. The guys playing stickball are all Mexican, except the one waving the bat around. He's black. Danny watches one of the Mexican kids lob a meatball down the middle, and the black kid smack it over the roof of the house. Watches everybody react, start dancing around, showing off. He'd give anything to be out there playing instead of standing here watching, trying to maintain the smile out of respect. He digs into his wrist some more with his nails, breaks previously broken skin, and pulls away. The smear of blood he wipes away with his other hand rubs off across his dark jeans. Back home, his mom is always on him to stop digging, but that only makes him want to dig more. Danny looks around the cul-de-sac. Everyone is Mexican. The girls, the guys, the young kids, the mailman, even the mangy chocolate lab tied to a lamppost sleeping. He spots a pretty girl chasing a little boy across the cul-de-sac. She's tall and thin, Mexican like everybody else, but different. She's lighter, too, like him. Straight black hair past her shoulder blades, white tank top and long flowing green skirt. She calls after the little boy in Spanish, motions for him to stay off the lawn of a neighboring house. But when the boy suddenly plops down on his diaper in somebody's carefully manicured flower bed, all she does is laugh. She picks up the boy, brushes off his bottom, and leads him back to her beige towel. Danny gets a strange feeling in his stomach, a knot. He wonders, since she's light-skinned, if she has a white mom, too, like he does. He watches her carry the boy back to her blanket and sit down. Then he turns back to the guys playing stickball, wonders if his dad ever played here, if his dad ever stood on the exact section of cul-de-sac he's standing on right now. He pictures his dad's face, like he always does, the last time he saw him. They were on the steps outside their old apartment, 3 years ago. He wouldn't look up or say anything. They just sat there together, cars driving by, the sun going down, a beer dangling from his dad's right hand. The next morning, he was gone. But the reason Danny's chosen to spend this summer in National City instead of in San Francisco with his mom and sis is because he's got a plan. He's going to save his money and fly to Mexico, to Ensenada. He's going to track down his dad and spend some quality time with him, so they can get to know each other again. "Yo, check my new tattoo," Flaca says, pulling her jeans halfway down her butt, revealing the letters OTNC, written out graffiti style. "Ooh, that's tight," Sophia says, gently touching the skin around the swollen letters. "Lo's bro did it. Bet it hurt right there, girl. It's all fleshy." "Nah, Lo's older brother's good soap. I could barely feel the needle." "Stop lying," Carmen interrupts. She turns to Sophia, shaking her head. "I was right there with her. She was bawling her eyes out before she got halfway through the O." As everybody laughs at Flaca, Danny glances over at the guys playing baseball again. Nobody plays stickball in Leucadia. Why do white kids play stickball, he wonders. Maybe because they have real baseball fields, or because the houses are too nice, or maybe they just never thought of it. He turns to check on the girl with the kid again, feels the knot rise, then cuts back to the game. Home.